About here.
How far is that?
Oh, a long way. 5,000 or 6,000 miles.
Farther than New York?
Oh, yes.
Takes a long time by boat, huh?
Caspar, are you homesick? You mustn't be. You'll forget about it after a while. Why, you've got the whole world to see, and you're going to make a lot of money and educate yourself and...
Yes, I make a lot of money.
Idea. What good's it going to do you to take those lions back?
They'll be free.
What about you? You can't go live with them again.
Yes.
But you can't. Think of your people in England.
How do I know that they're my people?
Why, of course they are. Didn't we trace them through your father's hunting knife?
My home's in Africa.
Perhaps, to bring it to that one end that is the aim of alchemy, the total dissociation from matter in order to attain the spiritual. If there is one work most developed in this direction, it is the color tables. Color appears here as an artwork in the light of the teaching of Goethe, based on its use in the Book of Kells. In this painting I use the same yellow, green, blue, and red pigments that the miniaturists used for their work. I brushed them with extreme lightness as if to emphasize the material resistance of the pigment to the brushstroke. I used the purest materials in order to discount the material and evoke the realm of the spirit. The way things shape up, discovering ideas, and finding a way to begin are all considerations that have something to do with the paintings done in enamels. Anyone faced with these pictures can see quite easily that they haven't been preconceived or constructed, since the materials have a life of their own. So what's it all about? And the same thing holds for the gridded pictures. They are simply found pictures. This sort of work is made easier by drugs, and it makes no difference if it's a question of coffee, or sugar, or beautiful weather. You have to encounter a series of external shocks, which have already filtered into the picture, and you work your way past them into something of your own. These spots of paint already have an identity. They become starting points for a work that requires being accomplished. That may also have been a reason for working close to monochrome. For example, you look for a while at this blue azurite and you begin to see figures or a drawing. It gets to the point that they become so compelling as to pull you into the picture, and you live inside of it. That is the true and authentic space of the work, even if you only imagine it on the basis of a couple old forms. But the substance, this color tone, blue and this azurite, all of that is a part of it. I ask myself, who wouldn't be physically upset to have arsenic yellow spread on his nose? In this sense, my transparent paintings are above all physical exercises having to do with the workings of the material. This also explains M. longing for the medieval workshops where the painter's studios were alchemical laboratories. I am fascinated by the gruesome experiments performed there. For instance, when a painter ground up a heart in order to use it as material to paint a dying woman. I toyed with the idea of using ox blood for painting columns at the Venice Biennale, or perhaps using ground ox horns or bone powder. These materials change color with changing humidity. If there is one work most developed in this direction, it are the color tables. Color appears here as an artwork in the light of the teaching of Goethe, based on its use in the Book of Kells. In this painting I use the same yellow, green, blue, and red pigments that the miniaturists used for their work. I brushed them with extreme lightness as if to emphasize the material resistance of the pigment to the brushstroke. I used the purest materials in order to discount the material and evoke the realm of the spirit. All sorts of Baroque references started to come into my mind. These images were the result of taking in tiny little doses of arsenic, just from the smell of it. Polke the Alchemist is an idea that somebody once threw out into the world as a superficial definition of what I do, and as a term to feed to the public. But my interest in the subject comes from somewhere entirely different. We always talk as though we knew what alchemy was all about. But not even the alchemists knew what they were really doing. I'm convinced they were at a point where they were experimenting both with matter and spirit. Go to the roots. Like to like. When you get involved with it, you discover a very Jewish principle of Kabbalistic religion. Chemicals got into it more from the Arabs. The entirety of the more scientific side of alchemical literature comes from the Arabs. It's probably a question of a desire to create connections among the period's principal spiritual impulses. I'm not at all interested in any kind of alphabet or vocabulary of different substances. I find that every painting has an individual existence. This painting achieves one effect. The next painting with the same things doesn't necessarily work towards the same effect. But I know that the intentions are there. If L had been using acrylics, the whole thought would be completely different. This became clear to me while working with arsenic. There was a certain excitement about that too. Is it still poisonous? What's going to happen? Painting with arsenic makes you extremely sensitive, and there was a point where it changed my whole frame of reference in time. I slipped into 17th century images of some kind of alchemy, and for me alchemy is not only metaphorical but also literal. I do not see paint as the carrier of color but as the color itself. I am looking for the disquieting, sensuous aspects of color, rendering modern color theories almost totally irrelevant. For me, what at first appears to be a rest of color can actually be explosive as a material, as described by the theory of humors of medieval alchemy.
We'll be right back.